Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We gather today in the sure and certain hope of resurrection to give thanks to God for the life of Johnsie Abernethy and to receive the comfort of the Holy Spirit and to proclaim the good news of eternal life in Jesus Christ. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth, and let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks and bless you for the great company of all those who have kept the faith, finished their race, and who now rest from their labor. And we praise you for those dear to us, and especially we thank you for Johnsie, whom you have now received into your presence. Help us to believe where we have not seen, trusting you to lead us through our years, and bring us at last with all your saints into the joy of your home, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace. For thou, in the sight of others, they were punished. Their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive their great good, because God tested them, and they found them worthy of himself. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, How do you possibly capture 92 years of a life in a brief summary? A life that saw wall phones with a hand crank to smartphones, A models to self-driving Teslas, playing sports for the love of the game to $700 million contracts. As Mom was fond of saying, it boggles the mind. My mother lived an extraordinary, ordinary life, a gentle, graceful, happy, love-filled life. She was a devoted daughter, sister, mother, nana, church member, friend, co-worker, flower gardener, Tar Heel fan, Braves fan. Johnsie Faye did everything she undertook 110%. Our grandmother used to tell her to please just sit down. If Mom did not have things to do, she invented them. Mom was whip smart, and if she had been afforded the opportunities Dad and she worked so hard to give Jeff and me, there's no telling what she might have accomplished. Her work ethic was phenomenal. She was frequently awarded commendations from General Electric for outstanding job performance. She threw herself into whatever she was doing, be it cooking, canning, flower gardening, or church work. Mom taught Sunday school, sang in the choir, led women's group meetings. In all things, she was all in. Today is my dad's birthday. My mom and dad lived a wonderful love story. Dad was older than Mom, and they met through friends. There was an immediate attraction, but then Dad found out how young Mom was. I'm not sure what Madge and Woodrow were doing and how they let that happen. They must have been tending to the younger siblings. Dad distanced himself, and they went about their lives. After a year, Mom wrote Dad a letter, and lo and behold, when she went to the mailbox, she found a letter from Dad. They reunited, and a full year later, the rest is history. Britt used to love to tease Mom, saying that she ended Dad's very promising baseball career. Jeff was born a year later, and 3 years later, I came along. We moved into the house our master builder grandfather built on Rose Street. And yesterday, we were all there together again. It's been our home for 68 years. Although Mom can no longer live independently, I love to see her exercise her independence when I brought her home to stay a few days. She would walk in and busy herself returning all things to their proper order, wondering aloud who had moved her things. Hard work, going to church, and Sundays spent with grandparents, aunts, uncles, and cousins was our life routine. Family was Mom's joy. McCree gatherings were legendary. After church, Sunday afternoons were spent making homemade ice cream, eating watermelon, playing badminton, or just porch sitting with the whole clan. Thanksgivings and Christmases found us all crowded together around mounds of food prepared by Mama and each of Mom's beloved sisters. There were family beach trips. The McCrees loved and laughed at every opportunity. Mom told me beautiful stories of her childhood when she would go into her grandfather's house, she would be at her grandfather's house, and he would come in the kitchen and play pot lids and sing to her as a child. She could describe in intricate detail the McCree home place. She once escaped near death falling into a well on the property while she was playing with her beloved cousins, Bill and Earl. Mom loved to travel. My Aunt Jan told me yesterday that the sisters took about 39 trips. She had photos with Nick, think Young and the Restless, from a trip to New York City for Brooke's 16th birthday, and pictures with Irish tenor Daniel O'Donnell aside her sister Jo. She made innumerable trips all over the country, but the sisters' main ventures were the annual Black Friday shopping adventures to Charlotte and Gatlinburg. In recent years, my cousin Amy dubbed them the Golden Girls. I envied their laughter and camaraderie as they shared standing Friday night dinner dates. Most of those dates concluded with a ride by Krispy Kreme to see if the Hot Now light was on. In our high school years, Mom was up and gone to work before Jeff and I were even awake. Her days began long before sunrise, and she was on her feet all day. But she still had all the time in the world for us. We sat down at dinner to a home-cooked meal, said grace. I have treasured memories of how she came in my room as a little girl and turned my pillow to the cool side. How she held my hand and dried my tears and stayed up with me throughout the night after my first heartbreak. Baseball players were very superstitious, and my brother was no exception. He had a special shirt he wore into his uniform. We would drag him late from a night game, but Mom would stay up to wash his shirt so it would be ready to go the next day. She did it knowing only minutes later she would be up and headed to GE, but she never complained. She would have done anything for her baby boy. I reminded her of all she had done for us when she lived with me these past years. Her response was always, "I wish I could have done more," or "I would do it all over again." We were rich in love. Over the years, our family grew with the addition of her adored grandchildren, Brooke and Reed, and their children, Olivia, Will, and Hunter. She loved every minute she spent with them, watching them grow and achieve. She loved cooking their favorite meals when they came to visit, and one of the last things she made was a peach cobbler for Reed's birthday. I spent most of my career working with a keenly observant trial lawyer, and one of the most cherished compliments ever paid me was when he announced to a social gathering that if one were to look up the definition of family in the dictionary, one would find a picture of the Abernethys. In the weeks following our September celebration of Mom's 92nd birthday, she seemed to be withdrawing from us. She slept more and lost the enthusiasm she'd shown all those years. I remarked to her dear friend, Fred Thompson, that in hindsight, I think Mom had one foot here and one foot in eternity. Like her granddaughter, Mom had a beautiful voice and she frequently sang at weddings. Most often the song she sang began, "Oh, perfect love, all human loves transcending." Mom believed and embraced the promise of perfect love. Acknowledging the imperfections of human love, Mom loved unconditionally. Over the years, she cut Jeff and I a lot of slack. Each and every day, she lived to show love to everyone crossing her path. She had a smile that lit up a room. And as I look out today and see the faces of so many friends, I hope you know Mom cherished your affections. She loved her First Pres family and was so happy to make it back to services when she could. On the afternoon of December 12th, Mom's caregiver, Alicia, and I were sitting by Mom's bed at Solace. And I was telling Alicia Mom and Dad's story, how they modeled for me working at a marriage. She tried all her long life to live as perfectly as she humanly could. For 62 years, Mom and Dad lived life's peaks and valleys, remaining committed. At the end of my dad's life, it was my mom who had to reassure him she would be fine before he left this life for eternity. Listening to the stories of her final days with Dad, Mom drew her last breath. She was carried away by angels to at last encounter firsthand that perfect love. An unknown author wrote, "I am standing upon the seashore. A ship at my side spreads her white sails to the morning breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She's an object of beauty and strength. And I stand and watch until, at length, she hangs like a speck of white cloud just where the sea and sky come down to mingle with each other. Then someone at my side says, 'There she's gone.' Gone where? Gone from my sight, that is all. She is just as large in mast and hull and spar as she was when she left my side, and just as able to bear her load of living freight to the place of destination. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at the moment when someone at my side says, 'There she's gone,' there are other eyes watching her coming, and other voices ready to take up the glad shout, here she comes. Mom is home.
Well, Cheryl, you made that look very easy. Sorry. All right, here we go. Cheryl asked if I would like to share a few words about Nana. And like her, I wonder how it would be possible to sum up a person's life into just a few words. Of course, the answer is that you cannot. And the beautiful thing is that all of us here today have stories and memories about Nana, and her spirit will live through each of us. Nana's warmth and love were the cornerstones of our family. She made 1440 Rove Street the Abernethy Sanctuary, a place where love was unconditional and the door was always open. Even though it was never my permanent address, it always felt like home. During periods of instability in my life, a trip to Nana and Pampal's house would make all my worries slip away. I'm sorry. I'm sure that Brooke, Dad, and Cheryl experienced the same. From the smell of liver mush cooking at breakfast to the taste of her homemade sweet tea, Nana's kitchen was a place of gathering, laughter, and love. Unless, of course, you were Aunt Cheryl's boyfriend and served the only bad batch of spaghetti that she ever made. Her O'Henry bars were more than just a treat. They were a symbol of her desire to indulge me with the sweetness of her affection. Nana's legacy is not in the material, but in the safe and loving environment she created for each of us, which is a testament to her kind spirit and generous heart. So as we celebrate her here today, my hope is that we can all carry on the lessons of kindness and love she imparted. Her memory shall continue to guide us like the gentle pat of her hand or her comforting words. Let us honor her legacy by extending the same warmth and refuge she provided to all of us. I love you, Nana. Please give me a pimple hug for me.
The gospel lesson is from John 14. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How do we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Let's pray. Lord God, we come before you today, acknowledging your presence and asking that you would open our eyes to the truth of this glorious gospel and the great sacrifice that you, Lord, have made for us on the cross. With great appreciation, we come to honor you and your work through your servant, Johnsie. Illumine our hearts with a deeper awareness of your word and grant us grace to love you more and to love each other more. In Jesus' name, amen. For the Christian, a memorial service is very important, though difficult. When Jesus told his disciples, do not be troubled, he spoke specifically about his leaving. But this can certainly be applied very easily to troubled hearts when a loved one has passed away. When Jesus spoke of many dwelling places of the believer, it's a comfort to know that heaven awaits the loved one's arrival. Heaven awaited Johnsie's arrival. And he gives direction and assurance that faith in him, in Jesus, is the way to the Father. And I brought the John 14 a little bit into this very beginning when I say that it's here at a memorial service. They were faced with the stark reality of the brevity of life. Goodness, it passes quickly. It's here that we're reminded that each day is of tremendous value. There are no throwaway days in our lives. It's here that we receive hope after the loss of a loved one. Above all, it's here that we thank the Lord for his sacrifice on the cross, for our redemption, because through him we have life and we have it abundantly. On September 17th, 1931, Johnsie Faye Abernethy was born into this world. She was actually born as a McCree, the daughter of Woodrow and Madge McCree. But even before her birth, God the Father had claimed Johnsie and destined her to receive a unique gift mix and a purpose that would match her God-given personality, and it was God-given. As she lived her life and through the choices that she made, Johnsie touched our lives and the many that she came in contact with. I have no doubt that Johnsie was placed here on this earth on purpose for his purposes. Our Heavenly Father is very intentional about those things. In Jeremiah 29:11, very familiar verse, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare, not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope." I first met Johnsie at First Church in Landis. She and Gwen were listening to this soon-to-be graduated seminarian to preach. And I was met with her classic smile right then. This led to the invitation to meet with the search committee, and the rest, as they say, is history. Over the years, I got to know and appreciate Johnsie more and more. I'll read this that Jeff sent me, a portion of what you sent me. "Mama was truly kind, loving, and truly served her children, her family, her church. Actually, everyone she touched received her warm caring and her support. Serving, giving was her special gift to everyone." So very true. I think it was when Debbie and I had just arrived and we had a new house that had just been built. And we thought the house was going to be finished so that we could move right in. Well, it wasn't finished. And we, for some reason, we were at John C. and Harold's house. And we said that we're not going to be able to move in. You can stay here without hesitation. And so we did. We were allowed to spend the night at their house. Oh, they would let us stay longer than that, but that's all that we needed. Serving, giving was her special gift to everyone. They were always this way. Harold and Johnsie both, always this way. She loved her children and her grandchildren and her family. It was obvious that you dominated her thoughts. And I remember time after time, it may have been every single Sunday, I don't know. She'd come up to me and she would say, "You need to pray for fill in the blank." And it was one of you, Jeff or Cheryl, and then the grandchildren, then the great-grandchildren. But she would ask, "You've got to pray for." And it was every Sunday. It was amazing. You dominate her thoughts. She seemed to worry about you to a point. And it's probably a good thing, I don't know. But she wouldn't let you go. She couldn't let you go because you were there in her heart. There was a strong determination in Johnsie, a strong determination to seek the Lord's intervention in your lives and in her own. She earnestly wanted relief and healing for her children and for her grandchildren and for her family.
She would pray for all of you, so many of you here today. She would, it seemed, pray to the Lord for you and then hold on tight, hoping that the Lord, she knew he would answer, but she was holding on tight, waiting to see what would happen. She faced problems and adversities and physical difficulties, but her faith remained very strong. She might slip into the worry mode now and then, from time to time, and so do we all. But bottom line, she trusted in Jesus. She trusted him. In John 16:33, these things I've spoken to you so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world. Johnsie was polite. She was poised in so many ways, but she was no pushover. You know, sometimes, I don't know if you've noticed, but sometimes Harold would express his opinion on something. And with much passion, he would go into great detail about his opinion on various matters. But sometimes, I don't think I imagined this because it's in the back of my mind, sometimes Johnsie would bring a correction to Harold. And he would simply look to the side and say, "Well," and that's it. No argument. That showed great respect for each other. It was determined grace that I saw in her. Never wandering, she was never flailing at life, but she was focused. She knew where she wanted to go. You probably noticed a very courteous stubbornness, and I'm saying that in a very good way. You sort of referred to that, Cheryl, but a courteous stubbornness. An attitude of determination to accomplish what she believed worthy for the Lord. Johnsie knew that these words were real. Romans 8:31, various verses. If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Christ Jesus is he who died, yes, rather who was raised, who was at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword or any of the problems that a family might face? I just added that. But in all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I'm so grateful that I knew her, but I'm deeply, deeply thankful that she and Harold shared their lives with me and all of us at St. Paul's. She was a very faithful member of the church, very faithful member of the choir, always there. She was very faithful in working with the women of the church and just going down the list, very faithful in worship. She loved the Lord. She wasn't acting the part, but you could see it. It was the fruit that she bore. I was thinking of some songs I'm not going to sing, thank goodness, but Johnsie, I could see Johnsie easily sing "It Is Well With My Soul" and fit her very well, fit her to a T. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. And another one, "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh for grace to trust him more." Can't you see her living that out in her life? You can see it in her face. in that ever-present smile that they would greet you every time that you'd meet. It was there, her faith in Jesus Christ and her love for you. This was God's call on her life. It was Johnsie's decision to not take a back seat in life, but to live it out in the presence of her Lord. It's our choice as well. Psalm 139, for you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were all written the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. Johnsie Abernethy bore the fingerprint of God. She did in her life. Each of us bears the fingerprint of God. We don't bear it well sometimes, maybe a lot of times, but we bear it. Through our actions and service, we reveal what that fingerprint looks like. And invariably, that fingerprint is going to look like Him every time. When you look at Johnsie with your love and respect and the honoring of her, you're honoring Him because she lived it out. She lived the life out. We don't do this perfectly, as I said. In fact, our attempts to live out God's sacrificial love often seems hit and miss. But that's where grace and mercy and forgiveness come in. God's love in our hearts prod us forward to demonstrate to the world that we belong to Him and that we resemble Him in our living. Think about it. The way we honor God most is when we resemble Him best. In other words, as we look more and more like Jesus in the way we live our lives, our God is honored and He is glorified. Call it receive grace. That's what she received. She received the grace and then applied grace. She applied it in the life that she lived. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4. This is the love chapter, of course. Love is patient. Think of Johnsie when you hear these things. Love is patient. Love is kind and is not jealous. Love does not brag and is not arrogant. It does not act unbecomingly. That is, it's not rude. It does not seek its own. It's not selfish, in other words. It's not provoked. It's not irritable. It does not take into account a wrong suffered. In other words, it doesn't have a record of wrongs. Love forgives. That's love. It does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. We all saw Johnsie live this out in a beautiful, beautiful way. And of course, this is Harold's birthday, and I thought it's fantastic to know that. This afternoon, we recognize with great thankfulness the birth of Harold on this earth. We're very thankful for Harold. And we sadly, yet joyfully, celebrate Johnsie's homecoming at the same time. Wow, what a combination. Their lives were intertwined. For 62 years, their lives were intertwined. Now they have an eternity together in heaven. It would seem that we've been left with a great deficit. In some ways, I guess we have. Strong, godly family and friends who live Christ-like lives such as Johnsie are irreplaceable. She won't be replaced. Can't be. And yet, the Lord is faithful. The Lord is still faithful. In John 14, Jesus said, I'll ask the Father, and He'll give you another helper, that He may be with you forever. I will not leave you as orphans. I will not leave you desolate, bereaved, without benefit of parents. I'll come to you. It's a promise. And through the help of the Holy Spirit, we take what others have taught us, live out the lives the Lord has given us, and glorifying Him in all things, so that others will see Him and believe and obey. 2 Timothy 4, verse 7. This is for Johnsie. This is something we should strive for. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I've kept the faith. When I look back at the love chapter of the Bible, when I look think back at what I've seen in Johnsie and what I've experienced in her touch in my life and your lives as well, in many ways, I submit to you a life well lived. She knew Jesus. She lived it out. That's a life well lived. On Tuesday, December the 12th, the world was continuing its movement toward eternity, and each person was investing the life they were given by God the Father. That's all of us here today. But that day was special. Special for Johnsie, for it was the day that the Lord said, it was her Redeemer speaking, it was her Creator that she served. The Lord said, in effect, it's time, daughter, it's time. Then one day, we who believe, we will all see Johnsie. We'll see Harold too, of course, and all those who have gone on before. Those who have placed their trust in Jesus Christ. But best of all, we'll see the one who made it all possible, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Beauty of fear, the terror of the night.
Let's pray.
Oh, Lord God, you are the giver of many magnificent gifts. Gifts. You've given us the gift of creation, the gift of family and friends, the gift of what we're really in awe of, Lord, is the gift that you've given of yourself. For you have given us yourself when we didn't desire you, we didn't ask for you, but we desperately needed you. And so Lord, we thank you this day as we remember the passing of one of your daughters. We give you thanks, Lord, that you have provided a way for her, for each one of us, through the sacrifice that you've made on the cross for each one of us. So, Lord, we just give you thanks. And I ask a special blessing on each and every person here today, especially the family. I lift them up to you, Lord. The pain is deep, and it's difficult to overcome. But you're able, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you'll bring back the wonderful memories and bring the healing that only your Holy Spirit can bring. And bring to them, each and every one, a sense of your presence so that their grief will be turned to joy. That's something that we can't conjure up, because that's something that comes from your very hand, your loving hand, Lord. So blessings on this family, on each one of us, Lord, and help us always to be mindful that this life is indeed brief, and help us to live every day as the day that is a gift from your very hand, that we should live for you and glorify you in it. We thank you, Lord, for that, for this opportunity that you've given us. It's a brief opportunity, but we come as we are, and we live this life. Help us, we pray. And should the curtain of death open in our lives, Lord, we know and we are assured that our faith in Jesus Christ will usher us straight through and immediately into heaven, into your presence, into the presence of our loved ones. And for that, Lord, again, we give you thanks. And we pray together now the prayer that the Lord taught your disciples to pray using debts and debtors. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you now to stand and recite with me the creed summarizing the faith that kept Johnsie going in life and in death, the faith in which she was baptized, and the faith we all hold together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. One of the things that Johnsie specifically requested was that we sing Amazing Grace with bagpipes at her funeral. Thank you. You only are immortal, creator and maker of all. We are mortal, formed of the earth, and to the earth we shall return. This you ordained when you created us, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant, Johnsie, with all your saints, where there is neither pain nor sorrow nor sighing, but life everlasting. And into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Johnsie. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you always. Alleluia. Amen. Amen.